I'm hoping that everyone in this room has done what I'm about to share. This happens to me way too much, and I will be out in, especially like a mall or some area where there's a ton of people, and I'll see someone. And I'll go up to them because that's just the kind of person I am, right? I'll go up to this person, and I'm just so excited to see them and to talk to them. And as I get out the first sentence, a few words, I realize it's not them. Have you had that happen? Really? I mean, I have this happen every once in a while. It'll just happen. I'm like, oh, they're so-and-so. I'm going to go up and talk to them. And then what I do, and this is the dumb part, is I begin to try to explain to the stranger who I think they are, and they have no clue who this person is that I know. I mean, it's like they're staying in their mind. Why don't you just leave me alone, shut up, leave, you know? But no, I try to explain away why I've just done this really stupid thing. The other day, I'm walking in the mall here at Markland Mall, and I'm going into Target, and I see this lady that I know, and I see her. She's way there, over there from a distance, and I begin to wave at her, and I pull up my hand, like I'm pulling out a gun out of a holster here, and I'm beginning to wave at her, when all of a sudden I realize it's not her, and thankfully I only got my hand up about this high. No, it was just hi, and then I just brought it back real quick, because I didn't have a clue who she was, and I thought I knew her. I hope I'm not the only one who's ever done that, I guess. But that happens sometimes in life, and this series is all about that. Do you know me? Do you know me? Do you know me? Do you know Jesus Christ? Do you really know him? We want to study, we want to learn together about that. This study that we're going to do is based on the book of Colossians. This is a letter that Paul wrote to the church in Colossae. These are brand new Christians that, I guess I could say it this way, if Paul was here today and he found himself at Markland Mall, he couldn't do what I've done to people in Colossae because he'd never been there. He wouldn't know any of these people, so he couldn't have made a fool of himself like I have many times. These people were brand new Christians, and they were in a city known as Colossae, not a real big place, but an important place at one time. And this was a place that Paul had never been, and you may say, well, how in the world was there a church there? Because Paul did all these church planting in the New Testament. He is on his third mission journey. He went to this region where Colossae was, but he had never been there. And so we learn about how in the world this church started if Paul wasn't there, and yet he's writing this letter, this epistle to them. How in the world did this church begin? And so you have to look at Acts chapter 19, looking at verses 8 through 10. In Acts 19, it tells us that Paul was in Ephesus, and Ephesus is in the same region as Colossae, and it says this in verse 8 and 10. Paul entered the synagogue, and he spoke boldly there for 3 months. 3 months he's in the synagogue speaking, and he's arguing persuasively about the kingdom of God, but some of them became obstinate, and they refused to believe and publicly maligned the way, referring to Christ's followers. So Paul left them, and he took the disciples with him and had discussions daily in the lecture hall of Tyrannus. This went on for 2 years so that all the Jews and Greeks who lived in the province of Asia heard the word of the Lord. So we believe this is where this church got its beginning. There was somebody there. We're going to talk about him here in a minute. There was someone there who heard Paul lecture, who heard Paul speak about the gospel and about this Jesus and what he had done for them. And so they come to know him. He was speaking in the region of Asia Minor, and that's where Colossae was. Now, this is one of those towns you can't fly to the Holy Land area, as we would call it, and find it. It's gone. There is nothing there. The Turks wiped it out in the 12th century, and today the region we're speaking of is, yes, the country of Turkey, is where you would find Colossae if we were going to try to discover it there. Paul at this time is writing this letter to them, but he's confined. He's in Rome, and he is a prisoner. And so he's writing this letter to people who he doesn't know, and he's a prisoner. Now, I'm always amazed at that, because I think if I'm in prison, I'm not thinking about anybody else but me, myself, and I. Sorry to say. Isn't that you sometimes? I mean, gee, here I am, and can kind of wallow in this. He's not wallowing. He's thinking about others. And he's very concerned about these new Christians in Colossae, because he has heard that there's some new teaching that's coming. And it's false teaching, and we'll talk more about that as we go through this series. This false teaching is invading the ranks of these new Christians, and he wants to make sure that they know, they understand who Jesus is and who he isn't. What would you say to try to explain to somebody, to try to convince somebody that you know Jesus? And here's what I think I would say. I think I would begin giving them a list. I'm a list guy. Some of you know me well know I'm a list guy. And so I would kind of have this long list. Well, I know Jesus because he was born in Bethlehem, and that was prophesied in the Old Testament. I could show you scriptures about that. He was born in Bethlehem, and I could tell you that at 12 he got separated from his parents in Jerusalem, and they, you know, it was kind of a weird thing that happened, but yeah, that happened when he was 12. And then later on he begins his ministry and he starts asking people to follow him, and he has these 12 guys. And these 12 guys they call disciples, and sometimes they do some really stupid things, but they were just 12 guys who followed him and spent 3 years with him. And I know what I would say. I would say things like, well, these guys got to experience things that I've never experienced, like the miracles and turning water into wine and feeding 5,000 plus people with just a little bit of bread and some fish. I mean, I think I would share all those things, but I know what I would share. I know I would share this, that he died on a cross and he rose from the grave. What would you tell someone today to try to convince them that you know someone, maybe like Peyton Manning? Would you tell them, you know, I know he was born in New Orleans. I know his father played football. He was a quarterback at Ole Miss. He went on to be an outstanding NFL quarterback. I know that Peyton Manning has two brothers. I know that Peyton Manning, he attended a high school where while he played there, their record during his time was 34-5. Pretty outstanding. I could tell you that he played for the Tennessee Vols College. And he was drafted, first round pick, Indianapolis Colts, played there several years, won a Super Bowl with the Colts, later on went with the Broncos, won a Super Bowl with them. He's retired now and has some funny commercials. I could tell you lots about Peyton. But do I know Peyton Manning? No. And my fear is sometimes I can be the same way about Jesus Christ. I can tell you all these facts about Jesus, but do I really know him? I don't want that to be said in my life. I don't want that to be said of anybody in this congregation's life. We can know stuff. Anybody can go Google Peyton Manning and know what I just shared with you. You could probably do the same thing, Google Jesus, and have all that stuff. But does that necessarily mean that I really, really know him? Do I really know Jesus? And so I believe in this letter to these Christians in Colossae, he wants them to really get who Jesus is. He wants them to understand Jesus maybe in a brand new way. So let's look at it together. We're going to look at the first section here in Colossians 1, verses 1 through 8. Colossians 1, 1 through 8. And he begins by saying this. He says, Paul, an apostle, he's going to kind of give his credentials here of who he is. And he's also going to share about someone else here. He says, Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, and Timothy, our brother. Timothy and Paul went on this third mission trip. They know of these people in Colossae who are Christians, to the holy and faithful brothers in Christ at Colossae. Grace and peace to you from God our Father. Okay, verse 3. We always thank God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, when we pray for you. And here's why. Because we have heard of your faith in Christ Jesus and of the love that you have for all the saints. The faith and love that spring from the hope that is stored up for you in heaven and that you have already heard about in the word of truth. The gospel. The gospel that has come to you. All over the world, this gospel is bearing fruit and growing, just as it has been doing among you since the day you heard it and understood God's grace in all its truth. You learned it from Epaphras, our dear fellow servant, who's a faithful minister of Christ on our behalf, and who also told us of your love in the Spirit. First 8 verses, what do we learn? We learn who's writing the letter. It's Paul. But we also learn that he starts off in a very positive way, talking to these people of, hey, I know about you guys. This is pretty cool. I know of your faith. Your faith is outstanding. I've heard about this. Even though I'm in prison far away, I'm hearing about your faith, and I'm hearing about your love that you have for one another. You have love for the saints, love for brothers and sisters in Christ. This is a really cool thing. And I know where this faith and love came from. It sprang up from something. It sprang up from the hope that you have. It sprang up from the hope that you have. And the hope that you have is based on one thing. It's based on the gospel. Now, I know I've said this many times here, but I'll say it again. The gospel, when we see that word in Scripture, it always is that whole idea of good news. God provided what we needed. He made a way for us to be forgiven. Without Christ's sacrifice, We have no hope. He's reminding them, hey, you have faith and love based on this hope that sprang up from you, from the gospel. You know about Jesus. You know about his life. You know he lived a perfect life. You know he died on the cross to be that sacrifice for all mankind's sin, and he rose from the grave. So this is where your hope comes from. That's where it's coming from. Jesus has solved the problem. Jesus has solved our problem. He goes on in verses 9 through 14. He says, for this reason, since the day we heard about you, we have not stopped praying for you and asking God to fill you with the knowledge of his will through all spiritual wisdom and understanding. And we pray this in order that you may live a life worthy of the Lord and that you may please him in every way, bearing fruit in every good work, growing in the knowledge of God, being strengthened with all power according to his glorious might, so that you may have great endurance and patience, and joyfully giving thanks to the Father who has qualified you to share in the inheritance of the saints in the kingdom of light. For he has rescued us from the dominion of darkness and brought us into the kingdom of the Son he loves, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. I want us to look at this prayer and what Paul wants to point out here, because I'm a little fascinated with what he does here. I'm not so blown away that Paul's praying for these people, but it's what he prays about. He prays that they would be filled with the knowledge of God's will. He goes on and says that your lives would please Jesus. He says they might produce being successful in leading others to Christ. The gospel is producing in other places. We want it to be producing. We want you to be bearing fruit, and we're talking about leading others to Christ. He also says that they'll have strength, so they'll have power. And there in that verse, if you could look at that, it talks about so that we'll have this power and strength so that we will endure and have patience. I was talking to a friend of mine this past week, and I was talking a little bit about the message, and I said, you know, this prayer and what he's praying, what Paul's praying for these people, is just as important for you and I today. How often this week did you pray for someone to have strength and power? How often have you prayed for endurance? So it's we get this prayer. We have another point here, that they will give thanks to God for what he's done. This is what Paul's praying for these new believers. Now, there's a part of me, I want to say, if you know a new Christian, what are you praying for? Maybe you're praying for some of the same things. Maybe. Or maybe there's a Christian you know, and you know they've been Christians for a long time. Maybe you're praying the same thing. I don't know. But I think, just like Winston talked about last week, sometimes our prayers aren't very deep. To me, these are not overly deep, but they're deep things that we ought to be praying for one another. Praying for strength, praying for power, praying for the needs of others, that we would remember to thank God for the gift that he gave us in his Son. So Paul prays for these people, and he prays specifically for them. So those are the first few verses of Colossians. So this is where we ask the question, okay, Steve, so what's that have to do with anything? Well, here's the question. How do these verses help us to know Jesus better? What do I learn about Jesus in these first few verses here, these first 14 verses? What do I learn about Jesus so that I can get to know him better? There's two things I want to highlight this morning. First of all, this, that Jesus gives us hope. That Jesus gives us hope. I know this isn't a newsflash, but politicians don't give us hope. Jobs do not give us hope. Business doesn't give us hope. Education does not give us hope. Jesus gives us hope. Jesus is the one who gives us hope. Jesus Christ is the one who is giving these new Christians in Colossae hope, and Jesus Christ continues to give us hope today. And the thing about this word hope that always kind of plays in my mind is, okay, hope. Yeah. Well, what do you mean by that? Because here's what I think. I think sometimes we think this hope that Jesus gives is kind of like all the Cub fans of the world. Now, I know the Cubs have had this great season, and I will root for them this year if they make the playoffs, which they will. But some of you Cubs fans are still saying, well, I really hope that they make it to the World Series, and I really hope that they'll win the World Series this year. But you're not sure. You've seen this happen too many times. Well, maybe not too many times, but a few times like this. And so you have this hope. I do not want you to think like a Cubs fan when it comes to Christ hope. It's not a hope-so kind of hope. It's a confident hope. It's a knowing hope. It's an assurance kind of thing. It's the real deal. This hope is based on truth in God's word. And so I have hope. And this is why he says what he says in verse 5 and 6a. He says it this way. He says, so that, you know, if I'm a verse here. Yeah. He says, the faith and the love that sprang up from the hope is stored up from you in heaven, and that you have already heard about in the word of truth, the gospel that has come to you. This hope has come to you. You have it for the taking. It's there. The gospel of Jesus Christ is where you get your hope. The world says, as long as I'm alive, I have hope. We as Christians should get to the point where we say, even though I'm dead, I have hope. I have hope in Jesus Christ. And so Jesus gives us hope. Just as we say, many of us, Jesus is in control, God is in control, yes. Because he's in control, that gives me hope. But Jesus gives us hope. So when you think about Jesus, please think about more than just the facts of where he was born and he died and he did these things with these guys. Jesus is the one who gives us hope. Second point today, that we might get to know him better, is this, that Jesus gives us what we need. Jesus gives us what we need. I love this story. It's about a lady by the name of Kara Wood. She was 17 years old at the time. She was working as a waitress in a small restaurant in a little town just east of Cleveland, Ohio. And she was, you know, one of these nice waitresses, you know, just friendly, charming, delightful, good service, all those kind of things. And there was one customer that would come day after day to her section. His name was Bill Cruxton. And he liked her so much, of course, he would come there all the time because he was a widower. He didn't have any children, and so he's there three times a day. He's always in that same section because he likes her so much. And so in addition to her being this regular waitress for Bill, she began to do other things for him. She would run errands for him. She would sometimes come to his home and do some cleaning. I mean, they became good friends. And so Cruxton decided to rewrite who the beneficiaries would be for his will. And he made this waitress at 17 years of age the main beneficiary to his will. Bill Cruxton died at the age of 82 back in the year of 1992, and he left this 17-year-old waitress $500,000. Wouldn't you like to have been that waitress? Now, there's a part of me, I'd like to have been that waitress. I mean, $500,000, that's a lot of money. But my question for us today is not so much about her and her getting that money as, did she really need it? You see, Jesus gives us exactly what it is we need. And I'm not sure there's anybody here today who all of a sudden, if this great uncle or great aunt or some relative that you have died and you were maybe their favorite nephew or niece, and all of a sudden you find out they've left me $10,000. You're going to say, no, I don't want it. No, you're going to take it. I bet you'll take it. What if somebody in your family left you some very nice vehicles? I mean, vintage automobiles. You know, these are just in mint condition. I'd take it. What if they left you a boat? Or maybe it's a summer home, a cottage. Maybe it's acreage, 50 acres. It's yours. I would probably take all that stuff. But do I need that stuff? No. I don't need any of that. But what God gives me through his son Jesus Christ, he gives me exactly what I need. He gives me exactly what I need. And we see this in verse 12 especially. When he writes it this way, he says this, giving thanks to the Father who has qualified you to share in the inheritance in the saints in the kingdom of light. You have inherited something. You've inherited something, and it's something you need. Now, when I read verse 12, the word I see that just screams at me is the word qualified. Because today we have to qualify for certain things. When I think of qualified, I think about May, and I think about the Indy 500, and I think about these drivers, and, you know, they're trying to get their car in the race. We've got 33 cars, okay? So I've got to get the right kind of speed and get my car set up just right so that I can qualify to be in that race. I'm so glad the tornado happened after the Summer Olympics. I would have missed three nights of watching the Summer Olympics. How about you? I really enjoyed watching the Summer Olympics this year. Those athletes didn't just stroll into Rio one day and say, hey, I wanna run that race. Hey, I think I wanna dive. No, we know better than that. These men and women, these great athletes, have competed in other places to qualify so that they can enter into such a thing as the Summer Olympics. God has qualified you and I. I want to wake you up. Maybe it's too dark in here. God has qualified you. There should be at least one amen. God has qualified us, and it's not because of something you and I have done. It's because of what he's done for us. We have been qualified. He has rescued us from sin. He has rescued us from Satan's power, from the clutches of sin. We now are not in bondage to sin. We are no longer prisoners. We are free. And he now has qualified us for this eternal inheritance so that we have exactly what it is that we need. So, who is Jesus? He's the one who gives me hope, and he's the one who gives me exactly what it is I need. Give yourself a few minutes to think that over, and remember that's just some new things maybe for us today, or a new way of saying what Jesus wants us to know about him. Okay, so that being said, what am I to learn? How do I make this practical? How do I make this applicable to today in 2016? Okay, Steve, I hear you saying this stuff about Jesus, but what am I supposed to gain? What am I supposed to learn from this passage of Scripture beyond that? Here's what I think. I think that Paul wants us to learn things from Colossians chapter 1, not just Christians in Colossae back in the first century. And he wants us to better understand who we're to be. I don't know how many times I've had this question from people. Well, I'm a Christian now, so what's that mean? What am I to do? How am I to act? How do I behave? What should I say? What should I not do? Because what we want is kind of what Steve wants. I want a list. God, if you could just give me a list of 12 things I'm to do, maybe another list of 1,500 things I'm not to do, whatever. I think that would make it so much simpler, wouldn't it? I mean, I look for this all through the Bible. I don't really find it, put it in a list way, because he wants us to live this out and kind of depend on him. Yeah. But Paul does give us some things here that we need to sink our teeth into and understand and get and gain and grow from. So what are we supposed to be as a people? As Christians, as followers of Christ, he says, first of all, we're to be a people of faith. We're to be a people of faith. I know I've just blown everybody out of the water here. That's a new one, right? No, it's not a new one. I get that. But we're to be a people of faith. I love this story about a couple who were trying to figure out where God was going to use them. Their names were Mr. and Mrs. John Perkins in 1908. In 1908, John Perkins and his wife, they traveled aboard a steamship rounding the coast of Liberia, and they believed that God wanted them to be used to reach other people for Christ somewhere in Africa, but they didn't know exactly where. And so as this ship made its way around what is referred to as Garraway Bay, they sensed God's prompting, the Spirit prompting them to stop the ship and get off the ship. This is where God wants us to be. The thing that's interesting about this story is, unknown to them, there was also a young man living in that region by the name of Jasper Toe. And Jasper Toe was a God-fearing man who practiced tribal rituals, but he had never ever heard the name of Jesus. And one night it is said that he, under the stars, said this: "If there is a God in heaven, help me find you." And as Jasper Toe stood under the stars, a voice he never heard before said this: "Go to Garraway Beach, and you will see a box on the water with smoke coming out of it. And from that box in the water will come some people in a small box. And these people in this small box will tell you how to find me." Jasper Toe traveled for some 7 days to arrive at Garraway Beach, and he arrived there on Christmas Day back in 1908. And from the shore, he saw a box, and he saw a box with steam coming out of it. Of course, it was the steamship, a steamboat. And out of that box came another box, because it was in that same place where Jasper Toe was that John Perkins told the captain of the ship, "This is where we need to get off." The captain of the ship turned to him and said, "There is no way I'm going to let you get off the ship. This is cannibal country, and anybody who goes in there, they never come back out." John Perkins insisted that he let them off because God had told them that this is where we need to get off the boat. And so reluctantly, this captain did. He stopped the steamship, got him and his wife and their belongings finally into a little canoe. And when they got nearer to shore, here was this man named Jasper Toe. And he was there to welcome them and greet them. They could not understand each other, could not speak the language, but Jasper Toe began pointing to them and directing them, and he directed them all the way back into his little village. And while they were in that village over a period of time, they learned the language, and they started the first church in that region, in that village. And guess who the first convert was? It was Jasper Toe. Those who knew him at the end of his life described Jasper Toe as one of the godliest men that they had ever met. What if John Perkins had said, "That can't be what you want me to do, God"? What if he had said that? What if he had dismissed this? Even as I share a story like that, I think we're skeptical. I think we are. But I think we see the fruit in the end of the story. And if God is prompting you to do something today, do it. Maybe you don't feel that prompting right now, but maybe it's going to happen tomorrow, tonight, next week, next year, I don't know. But if God is prompting you to do something, you need to do it. And you that were here last week, Winston asked us this question, and I didn't like it. I didn't like his question. Do you remember the question? It went this way. He said, "What are you doing right now to exercise your faith?" And I'm sitting there thinking, right now, what am I doing to exercise my faith? I don't want to hear that question, Winston. But it's a great question for us. What are you and I doing to exercise our faith? We exercised our faith maybe one time in our life. And that was to say, "God, I know what you've provided, this thing called the gospel, and I don't want to go to hell, and I want to go to heaven, and I want to be forgiven. And so I exercised my faith that day, and so I decided to be a follower of yours." If that's you today, you are to be exercising your faith more than one time. We should be exercising our faith all the time. All the time. That should be a daily occurrence that we're exercising our faith. Now, it may not be in a great dramatic way as getting off a steamship and going in tribal country. I get that. But we're to be a people of faith. And that's what Paul is so excited about these new Christians. He's heard about their great faith in God. So what is it that God's prompting you to do? Is he prompting you to go to a mission field? Is he prompting you to talk to that person in your family, that friend, that person at work that you know doesn't have any relationship with God? They don't go to church. They're far from God. Is God prompting you to have that discussion? Is God prompting you to do what Winston encouraged us to do last week? And how'd that go, by the way? 15 minutes a day of prayer, right? Did you remember? I hope you did. If you didn't make 15, made 12 or made 20, that's okay. But is God prompting you to connect with you, that he wants you to connect with him more in prayer or more in his word? Just be still and know that I'm God. What is he prompting you to do? Is God prompting you to give more to him? Is God prompting you to give more to him? I have this great friend of mine that I love friends because you can go years without talking to him. When you talk to him, it's just like, yeah, that's my friend. And so we talked on Labor Day, and he was in my wedding. We go way back, and he lives over in Illinois, and we just got caught up a little bit. And he goes to the church where my dad used to preach. It's the church where I was baptized and all those cool things. And I always ask him, I say, "Well, how's things going at church?" He says, "You know, Steve, wasn't going too good for a while." I said, "What do you mean?" He says, "Well, we were really struggling financially." I'm like, "Oh, okay." I said, "What happened?" He said, "Well, you know, one Sunday, our minister, he just got up and he said, he just challenged us. We need to give more." I said, "How'd that go?" He says, "Well, in the next several weeks following that, our general giving went up $3,000 more a week." I want to do that today. It's the last thing you want to hear. I know it. Money's personal, isn't it? It's God's, but we know that, but it's personal. I want to challenge you to give more. I want to challenge you to give more financially to the ministry of this church. I want us to take a lesson from that church. I want you to give more financially to the ministry of this church. And so I began thinking about asking you that question. I began asking this question myself. Okay, what is faith? Well, Hebrews 11:1 says, It's sure, you know, these things I hope for, I'm sure those things I hope for, and certain of those things I do not see. So what's giving faith look like? Well, giving faith to me sounds like one of these things of, I'm going to trust God that you're going to provide for me because your word says you're going to provide for my needs. I'm sure you're going to do that. And I'm certain of what I'm certain somehow it's going to work out. I mean, have you ever thought about that? What does faithful giving or giving faith, however you want to say that, what does that look like? What's that like? I think it has something, it looks something like this thing of, if I give that amount, I'm not sure how I'm going to do without that, so I can't do that. Then I'm not giving in faith. And so I want to encourage you to give in faith. And when I was thinking about this message, it was interesting. Friday, I went down to Indy and stopped in to see Josh Burnett, and Josh is doing better. Continue to pray for Josh. He is improving, and you can find out more about that later. But as I was visiting with Chris and Susan, his parents, who he'll be there 6 weeks come Tuesday, we were talking to this nurse and just having a great discussion, and found out that she was a follower of Christ and where she goes to church and all this. And it was just interesting. She said, you know, for years in my church, I always worked in the nursery. And then for a while, I began serving with the two-year-olds. But I decided it was time for me to get out of the comfort zone. I said, what do you mean? She said, well, I teach third grade girls now, and they really stretch me. But she said, it is so rewarding. But what caught my ear most about that was that she said, I knew it was time for me to get out of my comfort zone. And maybe the same's true with us financially, that we need to get out of our comfort zone on a regular basis when it comes to financial giving. So I need to say this morning, that we are doing better financially than we were at the end of July, but we got a long way to go. And you're saying, well, why is that? Well, that is because this year, as we've traveled through this year of 16, our giving hasn't been good, and that catches up with you after a while. And we didn't have money set aside in savings to help pay the bills. I want you to understand the gravity of our situation, but I don't want you to think of Chicken Little, because the sky is not falling, and God will take care of us. But the gravity of it was we got to a point we couldn't even pay missions and missionaries. We had to hold checks that would normally be sent out to a certain time to missions and missionaries. And those people depend on those funds. We weren't sure we were going to make payroll that week. So things have been extremely tight, the tightest I've ever seen in 22 years of being at Chapel Hill. I know those people are depending on you and I. And one of those places is starting today that depends on you and I so much, and that's Revive Christian Church in Loveland, Colorado. I can't wait to talk to them later today to see and hear what God did with their first morning in Loveland. We send Revive Christian Church $700 a month. They are depending on that $700 a month as they reach out to the Loveland area. So let's not forget how important it is that we give. And I will say it this way. If you and I, on a weekly basis, would give an extra $10, we would be in such a much better financial situation. Would things be better? Yes, they would be much better. And we would have some savings set aside so that if something came in that we weren't expecting to happen, we could pay for that without knowing where are we going to get the money. So I just want to encourage you to do that. And we're going to do something I don't do too often, but we're going to just pause right now and pray about that. So if you'd bow with me in prayer. Father, we know that you give us all that we have. And we know, at least in our heads, that all that we have is yours. And so, God, I pray that we will be people of faith in every way, even in our giving. And God, I pray that when we hear and are encouraged to give, that we will understand all those things, and that we will understand with monies that we give that we're planting seeds, that we're sharing the gospel, not only here in our community, not only here in the States, but around the world. And so God, I pray for blessings. I pray that you would bless each gift that's given. God, I'm mindful of that young boy who came to me last week, and he missed putting his offering envelope in the bag as it came around. He couldn't have been maybe 8 years old. And he wanted to give me his offering. And on the outside of that offering envelope, I can just see it's still God, that he had his name and a dollar. And God, it made me think of the widow who just had a mite. And so help us to think about our giving and where it needs to be. God, maybe that's a less stops at Starbucks. Maybe that's one less pizza. Maybe that's whatever. But help us think about giving to you so that you can do some really cool things, so that we do not hold back what you want to have done here. And so God, help us to plant the seed of your gospel. God, I thank you for each person here who gives faithfully, and I thank you for the love offering that we received a few weeks ago. So thankful for all of that. And so may people this morning hear that in my prayer, that we are appreciative. Guide us now, God, to be people of faith. I pray this in your name. Amen. Okay, God wants us to be people of faith. God also tells us, Paul tells us, that he wants these people to be something else. He wants them not only to be people of faith, but God wants them to be people who love others. And I hope you heard that in the text. He's so blown away by their faith, but he's so blown away by their love that they have for one another in Christ. Now, one of the reasons you and I don't love each other, we don't know each other. So let me say it this way. Please take advantage of the times you have before you're seated and after the service is over to talk to one another. I mean, the challenge can be for you this week. Get to know somebody new here today. And you may say, well, that's not the kind of person I am. Get over yourself, please. You're in the family of God. What are you going to do in heaven? Oh, I don't know you. I can't sing with you today. I mean, really? I mean, think about it. We need to learn to love one another, and that has to begin by simply getting to know each other. I know you can't know everybody. I get that. But I think sometimes we don't even try to get to know a name and a face and that kind of thing. If you really want to love one another, I want to encourage you to be part of a growth group. And you're going to be hearing more about that over the next this month. And so what's so great about a growth group is I really get to know those 9, 10, 15 people or how many other people are in your group, because now you get to look into their life and they share stories and needs and concerns, and we know funny things about one another, we know serious things about one another, but we know each other, and I can love on those people in a whole different kind of way. So really encourage you to get into a group. One of the ways that you can love one another and we can have that love for one another we should have is by looking around. And who is the person that you usually see at church and they're not at church? And you can assume a dozen things. Well, they must be sick, or they must have left the church and are going to another church now, or they may be out of town, or they're on vacation, or their kids are in travel ball and they're gone. You don't know any of those things. So let's not assume. And let's let people know that we normally see at the church, say, hey, I haven't seen you in 2 or 3 weeks. Are you okay? Just really miss seeing you at church. That goes a long way. And maybe in the midst of that, we're going to find out, well, you know, I've left Chapel Hill and I'm going to this other church. And if they found another church, that's great. But sometimes people leave and they don't go to church anymore. We need to invite them back. We need to encourage them. You need to tell them what you believe you're receiving as you come to worship at Chapel Hill. The strength that maybe you're gaining. I hope there would be things you could share with them about that. So don't just let that go. That's one way we share our love for people around us. And the other way I want to say briefly here is by serving. And I think sometimes this is just almost like giving financially. It's just, oh, he's going to talk about that again? Yeah, I am. We need people who are servants. And whether it's in the nursery or wherever, but I really want to highlight today Pathways. And Pathways, some of you already know this, is our special needs ministry. And some of you say, Steve, that's really out of my comfort zone. I get that. But it doesn't have to be, because it's one of these things where we will help you with that. We won't put you in a situation where you won't have more to handle than you can. We have families. The only reason they started coming to Chapel Hill was because we had a ministry for special needs kids. And I know some families that used to live in other cities who would tell me, you know, 1 week my wife would come and then I would stay home with the kids and the next week we'd flip. Our families don't have to do that, but that still takes volunteers. So there's a table out in the foyer about Pathways. We really need your help. And that's something that happens at 11 o'clock. You can come to worship at 9:30 and go serve at 11 in our pathway. So that's a neat way to push yourself in your faith, get out of your comfort zone, and help these parents and these families get to know more about Jesus Christ. All right, two other things. Bear with me, two more things. The other thing that Paul says that we ought to be a people of, not only be a people of faith and be a people who love one another, but he says a people that pray, and that's what he does in verses 9 through 13. We talked about prayer last week, as Winston shared, pray strong. We encourage you to pray 15 minutes last week, all that. So that's my point. Okay, we're going to move on. The last point is this, that he says, as a people, we're to be the people who joyfully give thanks. Are we Thanksgiving kind of people? Do we give God thanks? Do we give him praise? That's a question for all of us to answer. Are we doing in such a way that we show our joy? Are we joyful? Are we full of joy knowing about Christ and what he's done for us? Do we get it? Or have we heard it so many times that it's like it's taken for granted and I just assume it? So I don't want us to assume it, and I don't want us to get to the point, well, yeah, thank you, Jesus, amen. No. Again, Jesus gives us hope. Jesus is the one who meets the need we have. He's given us an inheritance we don't deserve, but he's qualified us for by giving his life for us. You and I need to daily be thanking him in a joyful way, whether that's singing to him, praising him, shouting glory to him, God, thank you, hallelujah, because there's no way my needs can be met without you. I joyfully want to give thanks to you. I wore this shirt today to remember those people who gave their lives 15 years ago, who went into places to care, to show love, but to do this, to rescue people. We are thankful and we remember those men and women who went in on 9/11, who rescued others. We give them thanks. We give praise to those people. We lift them up. We need to be doing the same with God. Check out this clip this morning.